हरे कृष्णा, वेलकम टू गोवर्धन इको विलेज स्पेशल सीरीज ऑफ टॉक्स ऑन द ओकेजन ऑफ नेशनल न्यूट्रिशनल वीक. मेनी ऑफ यू मे नॉट बी फेमिलियर व्हाट इज दिस स्पेशल नेशनल न्यूट्रिशनल वीक. दिस वॉज इंस्टीट्यूटेड वे बैक इन 1982 विद द इंटेंशन ऑफ एजुकेटिंग पीपल ऑल ओवर इंडिया रिगार्डिंग द इम्पॉर्टेंस ऑफ हैविंग द राइट डाइट. And you see, health and diet, they are so closely connected. So we thought Gowardhan Eco Village being this place of well-being, why not we launch these special series of talks, giving different perspectives, different dimensions on nutrition and health. So today I have the great privilege of presenting a unique dimension on food and the Bhagavad Gita, right? Now, before we venture into that, usually when we associate the word health, you know, when we talk about health, usually words like things like hospitals, healthcare systems, medicines, right? These are the things that come to our mind, right? But many times we fail to understand that preventive health care is actually more important than all of that. And what best source of preventive care than the food that we eat? It is the most important aspect of our overall sense of well-being, right? Therefore, food plays a very, very important role in defining the quality of our health. The Sanskritam word for food is ahara. Ahara means, the literal meaning is that it's an object that is presented to some conscious entity so that it can nourish and sustain it. Right? This is the very Vedic, very technical definition of the word ahara. Right? Something that is presented to whom? Another conscious entity, right? Another conscious living being, right? The food is given to another living being. So when you give fuel to a machine, that is not called food, right? That is something that helps the machine to run. But ahara or food is something that sustains and nourishes another conscious entity. So this understanding of ahara has been greatly deliberated upon in many Vedic texts, especially the Upanishads. Go on to question that how is it that food, which is finally, you know, some grains, vegetables, fruits, it's some combination of matter. How can matter nourish another conscious entity? How can matter influence consciousness, right? This is a very intelligent question, right? Because you see, even in our own practical experience, if we do not eat food for a long time, our faculties of cognizance, our abilities to even sometimes rationally think, to perceive things, cognizance and perception, all of these get affected. So we clearly see that there is a direct connection between the food that we eat and our overall sense of awareness and expression of consciousness. So this goes on to bring about a very, very important understanding that how, according to the Vedic philosophy, the food that we eat is not just matter. Food has two components. One, it has the material component that nourishes this physical body, you know, the material part of ourself. And it also has a spiritual component that nourishes the soul, that enhances its ability of expressing consciousness. Therefore, we have to understand food is both nutrition for body as well as the soul. Therefore, in the Upanishads, the food has been compared to directly Brahman, Anna Brahman. Anna means grains or food, and Brahman means that all-pervading divine. So food has been compared with the divine in the Vedic texts. So much so, in the Bhagavad Gita, even the act of growing food has been compared to something very special. It's not just, farming is not just an any other random occupation, but rather it has been compared to like a sacrifice, right? Because what exactly is a farmer doing? A farmer is not just growing some grains, but rather when done in the right way, farming is a process of spiritualizing matter so that it can become not only food for the body, but also food for the soul, right? Even the mere act of eating food is compared to be like a spiritual tonic, right? So therefore, in the Bhagavad Gita, in the third chapter, Lord Krishna, he compares that food which is eaten with this mood as a sacrifice, right? That yajna shishta santo munchate sarva kilvishe. So the act of eating food which has been sanctified as a yajna, usually when we use the word yajna, we think it is some kind of a fire sacrifice which involves some priests and fire and, you know, all the sacred ingredients, right? So that is one kind of a sacrifice. But when the food is grown in the right way, with right ecocentric values, respecting Mother Earth, that this food is being given as her blessing, as a manifestation of the Lord's blessings. And when one accepts such food is called yajna, or the result of a yajna. And such food becomes tonic for the soul. Not only does it nourish the body, but it also enhances the fine capacity of ourselves to perceive the subtle spiritual realities and expand our awareness and our consciousness, right? So therefore, that food which is sanctified is very, very special food. And therefore, in the Bhagavad Gita, the act of growing food also, Lord Krishna, he compares it with a yajna. He explains a beautiful cycle saying how, where are these grains coming from? How does the whole process of farming work? It works, it's closely dependent on climate, right? It closely dependent on how the rains occur, how the heat of the sun is dissipated, how so many external factors in nature function, right? All these factors, they affect the production of food. And it goes on to explain that these external factors of nature, how are they ensured? How are they regulated? By performance of these activities with this mood of sacrifice or yajna. And he further explains, where is this concept of yajna mentioned, right? This concept of everyone doing their own prescribed duties and acting in a righteous way, right? Living in a just way, living a very ecocentric life and not trying to exploit Mother Nature and literally force the grains out of her by throwing all these deadly chemicals into her, but rather honoring and respecting Mother Earth and accepting her blessings in the form of these foodstuffs, right? Where is this mentioned? It's mentioned in the Vedic texts, and the Vedic texts themselves are coming from the Supreme Lord. So you see the connection here, food coming from rains, from nature, and that act of living a nature-centric life as a yajna, as a life which is based on scriptures and scriptures coming from the Supreme Lord. And this entire cycle gets completed when at the end, the grains which we grow with this understanding are again offered back to the Lord as an expression of our gratitude, saying, thank you, my dear Lord, for giving me not only food to nourish my body and mind, but also to nourish the soul, for giving me this spiritual tonic, right? Therefore, see how beautifully the Bhagavad Gita presents that even in the mere act of eating food, spirituality can be expressed. And therefore, food is such an important thing. In fact, the Bhagavad Gita, in the 17th chapter, it closely connects the how you judge, how you understand the quality of any culture, quality of culture of any civilization based on its food habits. Because our food is very much connected to our consciousness, and our consciousness is very much connected to the culture of that particular civilization. That is how important food plays a role in the society, right? Just looking at the quality of food people eat, we can understand their value systems. You can understand how much of a principle of ahimsa they are following in their life, how much of the principle of non-violence they are following in their life, how much ecocentric they are in their value systems, how respectful and honoring they are with respect to people, nature, and all other living entities around them. So many things can be understood. The very the refinement of any culture is very closely connected to food. So therefore, the Bhagavad Gita very clearly presents how we can imbibe a very sophisticated spirituality-centric culture. We can adopt a spiritual culture merely by being conscious of what kind of food we eat. So in that same 17th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna elaborates how the food that we eat is a reflection of the different gunas or the modes of material nature which is influencing us, right? So everything around us in this physical reality is controlled, dominated by these three different cosmic energies. In Sanskritam, they are called as sattvaguna, rajoguna, or tamoguna. Sattvaguna is the mode of material nature, the energy which sustains things, which prolongs life, which is what is sustainable and healthy for us. Rajoguna is that agitating creative force. And tamoguna is that destructive, ignorant force. So the food that we eat also is influenced, and a very progressive, conscious, spiritually inclined person is very mindful about the food that they eat. And what are these foods in three modes? So Lord Krishna explains that food, which is in the mode of goodness, is something that enhances the duration of one's life, right? Ayu sattva bala arogya, right? It increases the duration of one's life. And not only that, not only does it give you a healthy life with a strong body, but it also purifies one's existence, meaning it purifies your own consciousness, and it gives strength, health, happiness, and satisfaction, right? Such a powerful, profound concept here. Think about it, right? Today we are trying to eat a lot of food. We have access to a lot of food. Apparently, statistics show how today we have access to a greater volume of food compared to some of the previous generations. But yet, people are not satisfied with what they eat and in general. Why? Because we are not eating the right kind of food. We are not eating sattvic food, right? So what are the examples of sattvic food? Lord Krishna explains, such foods are juicy, fatty, wholesome, and pleasing to the heart, right? Natural food, vegetarian food, right? Food which is in this mode of goodness is what that helps in bringing about all these characteristics. Then what about the other categories of food? Then Lord Krishna explains there is a second category of food which is in the mode of passion or this rajoguna. He says food which is too bitter, too sour, salty, hot, pungent, dry, and burning. this is the food in the mode of goodness. This is the food choice by people and cultures who are in this mode of passion, mode of rajas, right? What is wrong with such food? Lord Krishna explained that such food, it causes distress, misery and disease, right? And that's what we see around. A lot of the food eaten in the society today falls in this category. And as a consequence, we see that food which is supposed to nourish us and sustain us has become a source of disease and is proving detrimental to our lifespan, right? And then there is a third category of food, right, which is food which is tamasic, right? Old, stale, rotten food made out of decomposed, putrid substances, right, which is consists of remnants and untouchable things, right? Especially meat-based diets come in this category. And such things, these are dear to those who are in the mode of darkness, right? In such food, it clouds your consciousness. It clouds your sense of perception. And such food is not conducive for a progressive civilization. It's only going to create more ignorance and darkness and tamas in the society. So you see, the Bhagavad Gita, which is, you know, such one considered one of the most important spiritual texts ever, and spoken in the middle of the battlefield, right? And in the middle of the battlefield, Lord Krishna is talking about how to cook food, what kind of food to eat. Can you imagine? Right in the middle of such an, you know, such a serious scenario, in such a serious setting, if Lord Krishna is speaking about food, we have to understand what kind of a paramount role food plays in the overall well-being of the society. Therefore, in this special National Nutritional Week, let us become mindful of these concepts and understand that the food that we eat is not only something that nourishes our body and mind, but also we can use that same food to nourish our consciousness and nourish our souls, right? That will be our special learning for this National Nutritional Week. Like, let us provide nutrition to the body, mind, soul, and our consciousness. Thank you very much. This is what I wanted to share. I hope you all have a very nutritious week ahead. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.